More sound. Right, as we know, my name is Paul Bavister. I'm from BFLS, and I'm going to introduce a project called Soundforms to you. This is a project that I've been working on for some time now with some colleagues at BFLS, and I represent quite a large team, really, of BFLS, Arab Acoustics, the ES Group, Architen Landrell, Fineline, and the Total Solutions Group. Our project is really about portability, and it comes back all the way back to the yurt and early methods of portability in trying to get buildings to move around and be deployable. And also it comes back to the Commedia dell'arte in Italy, where it could be argued that commercial problems in Italy in the 17th century forced theatres to go out to the people, to create plays outside where there was a democracy of theatre, where people, anyone could go and see it, but they could pass around a hat and pay. So there's a certain sort of historical lineage that our project comes from. Also from the work of Buckminster Fuller and his deployable and industrial aesthetics of how to actually fabricate buildings. And this is a helicopter shelter by him. So music. When you hear a musical experience in a concert hall, you're hearing a musician responding to a room. They're making a music and they're responding to the sound as it comes back from all of the walls, from all of the surfaces. And they are responding to that. They're creating a piece. And they are also responding to you as well. So there's a reciprocal relationship between the space, the musician, and the audience. And this is one we did last year. This is the Royal Welsh College of Music and Drama. And every single surface of this building has been organised to actually reflect that sound back to the musician and back to the audience at the right ratio and the right proportion. When you have external performances, you don't have that. This is a typical tent, and I'm sure you've all suffered watching a performance in one of these things. They keep the rain off the musicians, and that's all they do. There's no acoustic support on the platform. So you, as an audience member, get a pretty shocking performance, because they can't hear themselves. If you have a full ensemble, an acoustic ensemble on a platform like this, all they can hear is their own instrument and not getting any cues from any of the other musicians on the platform at the time. So our brief really came from conversations with a conductor called Mark Stevenson in 2007, who was trying to develop a portable rig that he could take to play in atria and small office spaces, where he could actually start to have a coordinated room with which to play music in. These things do actually exist for internal use. This is a black cat system, which is developed to be flown in fly towers in theatres. If you go to see a classical concert in a theatre, all the music normally just goes straight up into the fly tower and echoes around, which is quite grim. So they fly these things down and you can get a reasonably good performance out of it. The problem is you need a fly tower to hang it. So none of these things exist for the outside world. And also in a room you have the ceiling. And the ceiling probably is one of the most important things, because it bounces back the sound down onto the audience. So you get that reverberance, that bloom, the glow of a sound, which you don't get in external performance. So we decided to write a brief for ourselves. I should point out at this that this was totally unfunded. We didn't have a client, we were just talking, and we were just an enthusiastic bunch of amateurs, really, who wanted to try and continue an exciting hobby, really, which is music and listening. So we developed a brief for ourselves, which was to have three distinct typologies of orchestra: a string quartet, a chamber orchestra, and a full orchestra. And we'd try and develop a series of acoustic ratios that would form a concert hall type environment that we could then take to the outside. So this diagram here shows you what those three dimensions were for each different typology of orchestra. Each single sound has a different type of quality, a different type of space that it needs to be in. So they were very varied and they were unscalable. And that gave us a little family, a small, a medium and large. And what we did, we looked at the ratios between these surfaces. What's the recipe that creates this? And we actually managed to get this recipe as a patent. So this project now is under patent all over the world. So this is an Odeon simulation of an acoustic tent, a fabric tent with no acoustic support at all. If you can imagine that the little yellow thing in the middle is a platform and someone's making a noise on it, and all of that sound is being spread around everywhere. Now let's hopefully this animation will work. Aha, purple snot. So all of these balls are representing sound flying off in every single direction. There's no control, there's no sound at all. So if you put in a little bit of reinforcement, like we've just discussed, by acoustic ratios between surfaces, then you get a lot more control. And here's the Odeon model of that sound being controlled. And hopefully we'll see now all of our purple balls being fired at the audience. So these things represent sort of the reverberance of the sound. So that's actually the way that sound is hanging around. And what we worked out while trying to develop an enclosure for all of this, because we're designing from the inside out at the moment. We're designing from what are the core orchestras, what spaces do they need to be able to perform. And while we were doing this, we discovered the effect of a peak. Now this is similar to the roof you're hearing now, because you're actually hearing my voice from my voice, but you're also hearing feedback from the room. So the ceiling has an important part. So this peak that we discovered here also projects the sound out a lot further. And here's an animation of where we got to after a little bit more research and development. Bam! Sound going everywhere. So we were developing all these walls, and here's more Odeon modelling, showing the actual total control of the sound that we were now getting. Whilst we were doing this, we were also looking at how to make the acoustic panels. These panels on the inside had to perform to a certain brief, which they had to be small enough to be able to be mounted and lifted by one person. They had to be dense enough to be able to reflect the sound back. And they also had to have, as we've just heard, diffuse properties as well. So we did this by making prototypes of these things and curving them. And the curving action took away all of the specular reflections which you get off hard surfaces, and actually started to break the sound, not in quite the same artistry that we've just seen, but in a much gentler way. The difficulty with these panels was that if they were too close to the orchestra, then the effect on the platform would be too loud. If they were too far away, then there wouldn't be enough reinforcement. So there was a lot of to-ing and fro-ing between Fineline in Bath, where we were actually looking at these prototypes and mocking them up. Because of the density, we had to have almost two layers of 18mm ply that had to be folded and curved. And curving that sort of stuff and keeping it on a former was very difficult. So in the end, we worked out the best way was to digitally route it out at the back and hold it with a stiffener. So we developed an actual spatial brief for the project. This is the main plan. We had a performance space and a canopy, which was the peak, two wings, and a back of house area. We managed to fundraise using lovely little models and inspired by the notion of a seashell. A seashell is mythically able to project the sound of the sea into your ear. Now, if anyone actually in this room actually believes that rot, go for it. They don't, of course, but still, the shape of the shell and the sound of a shell when you do put it to your ear is quite remarkable. So we were using this in conjunction with the shape of a torus, because if you take a torus and carve it, and I'm sure everyone from Foster's knows that you get the right amount of repeated geometry. So the torus, when cut, gave us, and the seashell, gave us quite a nice form. And these are some of the models we use. We did a lot of 3D printing in the office to try and generate exactly the right form. This is designing from the outside in now. How do we actually encompass and enclose all of our panels? And we had a lot of these things made to fundraise. We were going out to people and begging them for money, because now we were quite sold on our idea. And sadly, we don't have any of these left now. They all got stolen, which I'm quite thrilled about, really. I mean, they were beautiful objects in their own right. So this is more of our fundraising pitch. We had visualizations of it going into Somerset House and various other parts. And I ought to note at this point that a lot of talk has been made in this conference about digital prototyping and the role of actual 3D models being tested in the computer. And all of our work was done using digital prototyping methodologies. All of the clash checking was all done in 3D. All of the exchange of information between ourselves and the contractors was all done in 3D. In fact, there were no 2D drawings at all on the project. So this is a plan and top view of the final design, what we wanted to build. And these are our three families, the small and the medium and the large. Ultimately, we got funding for the small, and that was the one we decided to put into production for a one-to-one prototype. It wasn't a commercial model, it was a prototype. This was to test it and see, and make sure it would fail fast and fail hard, as we now know. So here's a plan of what we were going to do. You can see the structure coming in, which is an aluminium three-chord truss system, which is all around the outside. And the skin, we looked at lots of different types of skin. We looked at hard shells and soft shells, and ultimately for portability, the soft shell won. We didn't want the aesthetic of the tensioned membrane, which curves negatively. We wanted it to be plump, we wanted it to be just as the torus. So we did a lot of work with Tensis in Bath, who do patterning for fabric structures. Did a lot of work with them, and they did all the patterning for our project. And what we were going to do was a hybrid material. It's partially inflatable and partially solid. It wasn't going to be an inflatable structure because they just look like bouncy castles. We wanted something to have a little bit more oomph than that. So here's another section. You can see the acoustic panels riding down the middle and an inner skin, which I'll talk about in a minute, and the truss system. So this is the build. This is the base structure we were going to have. This is a 26 tons of concrete or water or sand can be put onto this. And then we started to put in the system lines. These lines here aren't really structural, they're just actually something for the semi-inflatable outer skin to grip onto. And then a goalpost truss goes up. This truss doesn't actually do anything structurally when the shell is complete. What it does is it forms something for all the other trusses to cling onto during the construction process. It's got to be assembled in 2 days and taken down in one. So it's quite an important key part. So here we have the development of the trusses going in one by one. Now all of these trusses are being linked in to a single point there, and they lift up like a pram lid. So all of these things can go up and they can be put into place by minimal riggers on site very, very quickly. And finally, there's the actual final system line, which is a really, really complex double curved line that runs right the way around the centre of the piece. So then we put the stage on, the acoustic panels can be dropped in, the inner skin, and then the first bag. Now the semi-inflatable panel comes in a series of bags, and this is the first one going in, and then a series of further ones. And this is the final 3D model that was coordinated between everybody. This is a photograph of the pinned truss. This is actually a steel joint with lots of aluminium trusses all joining it, which worked very well actually, and I think we're very happy with that, and I don't think we'd depart from that in the future ones. And this is the main thing being assembled on the site in the Docklands, using no cranes, just a forklift to hold it all in place. It's quite a terrifying moment seeing it all go up. This is another shot of the final test assembly. You can see all of the formers going in. Those white lines there are formers for the inner skin and inner acoustic panels. This inner skin is a fabric called Joel Elastic, which is an acoustically transparent fabric which actually masks some further acoustic panels for the inside of the inner cheeks. And it's beautiful stuff. It's like lycra, but sound can pass through it without being coloured or textured in any way. I love this image. This is the acoustic panels being finally flown in and put into place. It's like it's having its teeth cleaned for some reason. So testing. We finally got our one-to-one mock-up on site in the Docklands in March last year. It was a bitterly cold day, it was absolutely freezing, and we test drove it underneath the flight path of London City Airport. And we were lucky enough to have Nicola Benedetti, Charlie Siam, and members of the London Philharmonic turned up to play and test it. And when the first plane went over, you could actually see them starting to laugh. They did not believe it would work. But then the magic happened, they started playing, and all of the acoustic research, all of the homework, all started to pay off. The musicians could finally start to hear themselves, and they were responding to each other. And it was a really nice feeling to see them actually enjoying playing in the outside, because they don't enjoy it as a rule. It's a miserable experience. So we managed to get projectors on it and look at all of the different facets of what you could do with it. And it was a really good test. We learned a lot about it. We learned a lot of mistakes that we're not going to do again, like the way that we use a lot of industry standard fixing methodologies, which we now decide actually there was too much flexibility and created diffusions in arcada lines. The three-chord truss system was far too unwieldy and packed in too bigger way. So we're now going to use flat ladder trusses now with ladder truss stiffeners, so everything is two-dimensional and flat and can pack up into less packaging. And of course, less shipping containers means one's less truck, which means a lower carbon footprint. The testing was successful enough that we were approached by LOCOG, the Olympic folk, to be the official bandstand in the Olympic Park. And there we are, right by the velodrome. And I don't know if anyone got to the Olympics and saw us there, but it was quite a hoot. And we had lots of musicians there. And there was a strange thing happened while we were at the Olympic Park, and I'm just going to skim through some images here. But we had lots of throughput of musicians. Lots of people came in, and there's this rather amazing sign that I saw in the back of the sound form, where they were advising all of the musicians who were going to play on it that they had to be quiet, because they were all swearing on stage and dropping amplifiers on their feet and doing things like that. And of course, because of the acoustic, all of the families in the could all hear them. So I saw this sign. You can do that. And I think that's so we were quite pleased with that. Thank you very much.